This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
It's synchronistic, I think, that Lewis Proud is back with us. Lewis was with us a few months ago. He specializes in what he calls borderland phenomena. We will talk about exactly what he means by that. His new book is Borderland Phenomena, Volume 1, Spontaneous Combustion. Oh, yes, I'm worried about it, too. Poltergeist and Anomalous Lights. I called it a wonderful adventure of a book when I read it a few months ago and sent him a blurb for it. Jeff Kripal, my Supernatural co-author, loved it too. Mitch Horowitz, the publisher of Supernatural, called it a work of a gleaming intellect, and that is exactly what it is. Lewis, welcome back to Dreamland.
Oh, thanks for having me on the show, Whitley. It's good to be back.
Well, good. We, before the show started, folks, we talked a little bit about the crazy stuff that's been happening in my life, because it's kind of crazy stuff Lewis knows about. It's more of it is in his previous book, but we'll get to the material in his new book in just a minute. For those of you who don't know, I came back from a trip a week ago Sunday and found the following in my apartment. The smoke detectors were beeping because the batteries were dead. When I tried to replace one of them, the new battery was dead too. I then decided to go drive out and get some more batteries at the drugstore. My car battery was dead. And my car's not parked anywhere near the apartment. It's at the end of the building in a completely different area. So that was pretty odd. I had AAA come out. They fixed the battery. I got new smoke detector batteries, put them all in. Sat down to my computer to find that it was dead. I had to take the computer to a shop. It turned out that the power supply had been blown out by what the man who did the repair work said appeared to be static electricity. Now, Lewis, being an expert on poltergeists and all kinds of phenomena like this, you are literally the perfect person to ask about this. What do you think happened?
Right. Well, first of all, that's a really fascinating story that you've just related there. I know that we've talked about this before, especially in connection with my previous book, Stranger Electromagnetic Dimensions. You did describe yourself as an electric person. That you affect street lamps in particular. That you do have the experience of having a sort of static electricity build up on your body quite a lot, which is something that a lot of electric people describe. And that may, of course, explain what happened to your computer, because electric people say that they have a sort of unusual tendency to build up a static charge.
That's very true.
The weird thing, too, is it doesn't seem to be a case of them simply picking up the static electricity from their environment as would normally happen, like by walking across a carpeted surface or something like that. It seems to be as though the static is sort of generated from within the body. And it could be some kind of malfunction or with the body's electrical system or something of that nature. Or it could just be that you have a very sort of, unusual makeup in terms of how your body operates on an electrical or electromagnetic basis. These sorts of experiences get described again and again, and it seems to be related to a sort of – there's definitely an emotional component. Sometimes when people have these problems, electric people and all sorts of things are malfunctioning, they say that it's usually connected to when they're in an emotional state. They could be feeling depressed or anxious or angry or something like that. And I wonder maybe if in this case, maybe you – I mean, I'm not too sure what happened during your trip, but maybe you came home in a state where you weren't feeling completely at ease or something like that.
Lewis, that would be an understatement. What happened during the trip – and, folks, I'll get into this not here on Dreamland, but in another time. I may just do a completely separate show about it. I had major close encounters when I was in Texas, living out in a rather isolated house in the country, a place I've had close encounters off and on for years, and other people have too. So I was pretty agitated when I came home, that's for sure.
Yeah, right. Okay, fascinating. Well, I hope to hear more about that at some point, Whitley. It's very intriguing.
Well, I'm working on a book, and it'll all be in the book. So you think that this could have been generated by me? That crossed my mind also, but it just seems strange that the computer, the car, which wasn't anywhere near me, and all of that would all be destroyed at the same time. It's very distressing.
Yeah, and presumably, too, it happened – well, basically, you're saying that it happened while you were absent. So if it did originate from your body, I suppose, then we've got to take into consideration the fact that there's all that – well, obviously, that distance. There's a sort of, I suppose, non-local quality to what occurred. But again, this is not an unusual thing with cases of electric people. But yeah, no, I find it absolutely fascinating and baffling. And yeah, these experiences do get described by people who have had, you know, close encounter experiences and that sort of thing. And you have described yourself also as a fairly intuitive psychic kind of person.
Yeah, that's true. True. And incidentally, you're really talking to a choir here, because a lot of my listeners are in exactly the same boat. That's why they love your show so much when you come on.
Yeah. Okay.
Anyway, okay. So we're going to go a little bit beyond this, folks. Suffice to say that I've had all kinds of, and a lot of the listeners have too, electronic effects in my life. I've twice walked into different friends' houses and blown out everything they owned. And you think anyone ever forgets that? The answer is they do not forget that, because they had to replace their TVs, their radios, their computers, all kinds of things, and it was a costly business. And try getting an insurance company to pay for something like that. That is not going to work. Okay, now the new book is different, and why don't we start by telling us a little bit about what, and this is going to be a fascinating show, folks. Just really sit back and get ready to enjoy it. I'll probably die not knowing what the hell happens with all of this electronic stuff that happens to me, but that's okay. I'm used to living with it. But this is, we're going to be talking about things a little different, like poltergeist activity, spontaneous human combustion, mind parasites. And so you went from electronic phenomena into this other area of the borderland, Lewis. Why did you find yourself moving from one to the next?
Yeah, right. Well, I with this new book, it really came about as a result of a sort of a shift in focus for me, how I approach the paranormal, I suppose. And I decided to really sort of focus on the three areas of spontaneous combustion, poltergeistry, and anomalous lights, because those areas overlap to a remarkable degree. But basically, the term borderland is very important to my work and my thinking. And the reason I use that term is to refer to the phenomena that lie on the border or edge of this reality, things that are things that are neither here nor there, but somewhere in between, that occupy a sort of liminal nature, if you like. And the word liminal is from the Latin word limen. It means threshold. And the reason I use the term borderland is that I believe that paranormal phenomena essentially arise from another reality, and we only sort of catch, brief glimpses of those things on the border of this reality, where this reality sort of crosses over with other realities, if you like. So the borderland is sort of a strange, shadowy, liminal zone where other worlds overlap and interact with our own. And there are so many examples of this. I mean, if we look at sleep paralysis, for example, which is of course the topic of my first book, Dark Intrusions. Sleep paralysis occurs in that hypnopompic state of consciousness, where your body is essentially asleep and your mind is awake. So there's that interesting, sort of liminal nature of that state of consciousness, if you like, and that's where the paranormal manifests, because people report having all these strange experiences of being touched and hearing voices and that sort of thing. And although I do think that some of those experiences are, you know, sort of just physiological in nature, and we need to sort of take that into consideration, I think that some of those experiences also are genuinely paranormal, and people are sort of experiencing things that they wouldn't normally experience. It's because of being in that altered state of consciousness where your perception is widened, if you like. Just to offer one example.
Right. Free Dreamlanders, I have some bad news and some slightly less bad news. The bad news is that all of my gear is back, and therefore I can make commercial breaks again, and so you're going to be listening to one. The slightly less bad news is there's a lot of cool stuff on sale, especially a book you're going to hear about, In Hitler's House. It's a 2-volume faux memoir that I wrote under the name of Jonathan Lane, and it's one of the best books I've ever written. It's a really cool adventure that starts in 1931 and goes all the way through World War II. So if you're a World War II buff, you should really read it. It is well worth your time. We'll be right back. Did you know that you can get The Path and The Communion Letters each for $3.99 as ebooks on Amazon? That's right, The Path and The Communion Letters. These are two fascinating books. The Path, of course, I wrote. It is a really unusual insight into the Tarot and what it actually means, something that's probably been hidden there for a long, long time. But when you read it, you realize that the Tarot of Marseille had to be about this because it's so beautifully organized. It was a discovery I made back in the 1970s, and now you can find out for yourself just how powerful a presence in your life and a guide the Tarot can be. The Path, $3.99. The other book I want to talk about is The Communion Letters. If you have not read this, you need to. This is the best book of close encounter and abduction experiences ever created. It was created by Anne Strieber. The letters in it are now part of a permanent archive at Rice University, along with thousands of others that she collected. And I have to tell you, it is absolutely unique in the world. Also, $3.99. Don't miss either of these great books. They're terrific. And I'm very proud of The Path. It's unique in the world, and I'm so proud of Anne for having created The Communion Letters, also unique in the world.
You've probably heard the music for years. It's the theme song for Dreamland. But you may not know the name of the piece, The O of Pleasure, or the name of the composer, Ray Lynch. Ray Lynch is a 3-time Billboard Award winner. Ray is also the composer of the platinum album, Deep Breakfast. Pandora calls Ray one of the most influential artists in New Age pop and adult alternative circles. For music that will move your heart and set your spirit soaring, visit www.raylynch.com.
We're talking to Lewis Proud. His new book, Borderland Phenomena, Volume 1, speaking of well worth your time, this is a really, really good book because it, for those of us especially who know people or have been involved in this kind of edge stuff, who actually live on the borderland. And let's face it, a lot of Dreamlanders do, because I do. I mean, we do. We live on it. It's a really important book to get because you will learn a lot from it. Now, You mentioned this other world, Lewis. Where is it? I've really wondered about that. Is there some place where they are physical as we are, or are they just fundamentally a different part of nature?
Well, I think there's good evidence that we basically inhabit a multiverse. And this is something that, you know, mainstream physicists, of course, take seriously these days. And they've, you know, they're doing a lot of research into this. But essentially, there's one theory that says that these universes are separate, that they don't interact. But there are other theories which state that perhaps they do interact. And some of the strange things that we observe in quantum mechanics could occur as a result of that interaction between these various worlds. So I believe that there's good evidence that we do inhabit a multiverse, that there are other worlds, and that the beings or intelligences that inhabit those worlds are just as real as us. But if you look at things like the jinn tradition, for example, of course, the jinn are these beings that certainly the Muslims have a very strong belief in jinn, and they believe that they're behind such things as poltergeist incidents, etc. A lot of sort of so-called paranormal occurrences are caused by the jinn, in their view. But they basically say that the jinn are just as real as us, but they have the advantage of being able to perceive us, whereas we can't perceive them, or certainly we can't perceive them under normal conditions. So they would say that certainly, yes, the jinn are just as real as us. However, they don't seem to be as real from our perspective, because we only sort of catch very brief glimpses of them. They have the ability to essentially materialize in our world for brief periods of time. And also people who are psychic can also perceive them as well, certainly more likely to perceive them than the rest of us. So certainly these entities, hypothetical entities, I suppose, are just as real as us. We may not think of them in physical terms, but that's because they have their origin in another dimension. It's the same as with, you know, UFOs, for example. They have this ability to just sort of materialize and then dematerialize. And we find that in the case of a lot of, you know, paranormal phenomena.
You know, I wonder if you're going to have too many hosts who can come up with actual life examples for you to analyze. I'm going to do that now. I'm again back at this house in Texas. About a year and a half ago, I was sitting in the living room in the dark one night, about 10:30 in Texas time, and I had FaceTime on, and I was connecting with a reading group that I'm a member of out here in California, in Malibu, and listening in and watching. And as I listened in and watched, I noticed movement in the living room. It's a big room, but it was dark, and someone was walking toward me. It was pretty startling because the only other person in the house was asleep upstairs, as I knew that to be the case. And in any case, this wasn't a woman. It was an older lady upstairs, but this was a boy. It looked about the size of maybe 11 or 12-year-old. And he walked up to me. He was maybe standing at most 3 feet away from me at this point. We were almost eye to eye. Let me describe his clothing. He was wearing a shirt that had looked like it was maybe made of silk or linen, and it was tan colored. It was not so dark that I could not see some color in it. It had black vertical stripes and was cinched by a belt, and worked like a sort of tunic. And then he had on rather, loose-fitting grayish pants. I looked at his face. I looked right in his eyes. He was right there. There's simply no question about it. He was right there. He had on his eyes were looking at me rather interestedly, I think, because he probably had never heard anything like that going on in that house before. First time I had ever had this lengthy conversation there. But his lips were twisted with contempt. He looked like he loathed me. And then as our eyes continued to meet, I could see a question come into his eyes, like, can he see me? That was the question. And he suddenly just disappeared. Okay, Lewis, you're on. What happened there, do you think?
Oh, gosh,
I thought it might be interesting.
Well, I'm fascinated by these. Well, certainly this is sort of in a very similar vein to some of your visitor experiences, I suppose.
Yeah, except I don't think he was physical. He may have been. I never thought to try to touch him or anything, but he just disappeared before my eyes. And you speak in the book so much about these invisible beings.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I don't know. It's very mysterious. I mean, I wanted to actually describe an experience that my father had, my late father, Philip Proud. He talked about basically seeing this ghost. He was in his early 20s. He was living with his brother. They were sort of renting an apartment in Sydney. They were quite poor at the time, and they were sort of really struggling financially. But basically, he described seeing this ghost at night. It kept kept appearing every night. They'd see it, and it was basically just sort of standing there, pointing to something at the floor. And basically, they ended up sort of tearing up some of the floorboards, and they found like a small tin that had all these sort of odd things in it. There were like old coins and keys and that sort of thing, but basically sort of, completely worthless. But then the thing is, the very mysterious thing about this is that they said that they were, they started to sort of swipe at the ghost, and it actually started to break apart. And he described it as having a cloud almost. It had a sort of certainly it was very ghostly in form, but it there was some kind of physical aspect to it. And basically, they were swiping at this ghost, and it broke into little pieces, which sounds very odd.
Wow!
And it was sort of like luminous kind of material. And they said that every night they would see these little bits of ghost basically floating around the apartment.
How weird.
I know it's completely bizarre, but yeah, it's how do you, explain something like that? That there's all sorts of different things occurring. I mean, maybe in some cases we're basically seeing into another reality. Maybe to some extent that thing from another reality has materialized to some extent in our reality. It was your experience seeing that boy. I wouldn't know how to interpret something like that. I'm just as baffled as everyone else.
I think it's a place where there's a thinness between the worlds there, like there was up at my cabin. And I think Anne and I probably chose that cabin because we on some level sense that same kind of thinness.
Yeah. Yeah.
Another thing that happened there quite a few years ago, this was back in probably the late 50s, when my brother was a boy, and he and his cousin walked out on the front porch, and to their amazement, they saw off to the side of the house where there was an empty pasture in those days, another house, a yellow house, perfectly normal house sitting there. Mm-hmm. And, of course, they ran in to tell my mother because they were, they were little children, but they were not so young that they couldn't be astonished by the unexpected appearance of a new house. But by the time everybody got back outside, it was gone. The house was gone. Free Dreamlander, speaking of coming and going, it's time for you to listen up and go do whatever it is we ask you to do in these commercials.
Did you know that the Unknown Country newsletter is absolutely free and comes to you by email once a week? The newsletter has been published since 2000, and in all that time, not one subscriber has ever received a single piece of spam because they were on our list.
But what they have received, week in and week out, is the very latest from UnknownCountry.com, including a Dreamland preview and all the latest news. Go to UnknownCountry.com and sign up today. You owe it to yourself, and it's free. The new UnknownCountry.com is on the way. There'll be exciting new graphics, much easier navigation, the ability to subscribe either with your credit card or using PayPal, the return of our free message board and subscriber chat room, and so much more. The new site will be intuitive and easy to use, but it will also be demonstrated and explained on Whitley's YouTube channel. As to when, well, we're hopefully just weeks away.
We're talking to Lewis Proud, Borderland Phenomena, Volume 1, and we've been kind of circling around various things, mostly stuff that's happened to me. I want to get into some other stuff that maybe I've been avoiding it because I'm a little afraid of it. Lewis knows a lot about spontaneous human combustion, which has always worried me a little bit. Lewis, can you tell us what that is, and let's get into it.
Yep. Okay. Well, spontaneous human combustion is a unexplained phenomenon whereby the human body is almost entirely reduced to ash. Generally occurs within a period of around 10 to 12 hours. And basically, it appears as though the human body has caught fire from within, and then the flames have then obviously burnt that person to the extent where there's very little of them remaining. It generally targets the trunk of the body, and there can be sort of one or two limbs remaining unburned and almost basically untouched, with clothing still attached to those parts of the body. So it's very, very strange because, well, I suppose the really weird thing about spontaneous human combustion is that it's very, very difficult to burn a body to that extent. And the body, of course, is around 65% water as well. But basically, in a modern crematorium, they use, you know, various fuels like oil, gas, etc. And they use, of course, like a forced air to increase the temperature. And they need to achieve a temperature of around 1,000 degrees Celsius in order to vaporize and oxidize the body. And it takes around 90 minutes to 2 hours. But even then, you've got basically like quite large fragments of bone remaining. And they then need to place those fragments of bone in a device called a cremulator, which basically crushes it up and turns it into a powder. So in SHC, you sometimes see the bones being entirely reduced to a fine powder. So the mystery is, you know, where does the energy come from, and what is the process by which that's achieved in order to cause such extensive and remarkable burning of the body? So it's a very, very mysterious phenomenon.
Well, has it been studied? Have people tried to figure it out? Because I know there have been some extraordinary cases, like you mentioned in the book, the case of Mary Reeser.
Yeah, exactly. So basically, I suppose I should explain that, you know, the scientific establishment, they of course, accept that these things happen, but they don't believe that the fires are – or rather, they don't believe that the fires occur spontaneously. They believe that, you know, there must be some sort of external source of ignition. And they have tried to do experiments with, you know, wrapping like pig carcasses in blankets and then catching or setting fire to the blanket. They've always had to use some kind of accelerant, like, you know, petrol or something like that, in order to get the fire going. And the theory is that there's a that it happens via the wick effect. And basically that posits that the human body is kind of like a candle, only inside out, and the clothing represents the wick, and the fat of the body is the fuel or wax. And that basically once you catch fire to that person's clothes, the fat melts and then it's drawn into the clothing. But the thing is, these experiments haven't achieved anything as remarkable as what we see in cases of SHC. And the case of Mary Hardy Reeser, it's certainly one of the most dramatic and fascinating cases of SHC. If you Google SHC, you're bound to come across the famous photograph of her Basically, all we can see is just a foot still clad in a slipper, and the rest of her is just basically ashes. But Mrs. Risa was an elderly lady. She was 67 years old when she died. She was the widow of a doctor. And basically, she lived in Columbia, Pennsylvania, before moving to St. Petersburg in Florida, which is where the incident occurred. She'd been living in a apartment there for about 5 weeks when the incident happened. And it happened on the night of either the 1st or the 2nd of July in 1951. She was 170 pounds. And basically, her entire body, except for her purportedly shrunken skull, part of her left foot, and a chunk of backbone, was entirely reduced to ash, and also the chair on which she'd been seated as well.
What about the rest of the place? It must have burned down.
No, that's the weird thing too, is these fires are very localized. And in this case, the apartment itself suffered very little damage. So, you know, paint on nearby walls was, neither cracked nor singed. There was a pile of newspapers, just was in arm's length from where the easy chair had sat, and they weren't even scorched, for example. There was a daybed just a few feet away from the chair, and the sheets were, unmarked as well. So there was, of course, smoke blackening and soot, of course, in the apartment that had accumulated as a result of the burning. But that was just from a height of about 4 feet above the ground. So everything below that height was more or less unaffected. And there were two people who had seen her the night before. One was her son, Richard Jr. The other was her landlady, Pansy Carpenter. And that night she said that she heard like a dull thud or a muffled report, similar to a door slamming. She also noticed the very faint smell of smoke. And it was that morning a telegram arrived for Mrs. Risa, and she went to take it to her apartment. And that's when she touched the screen door and she felt that it was hot. And then she smelt smoke and she noticed, soot on the walls of the hallway and so on. And, of course, then the police were alerted. They did quite an extensive investigation into, Mrs. Risa's death. There was, of course, speculation that there may have been foul play, but of course they never figured it out, and they basically relied on essentially the wick effect to try and explain it. They said that she had been smoking. I mean, she was of course a smoker, that she'd fallen asleep and that she'd dropped the cigarette. It had fallen into the chair, onto the chair rather, and then the chair had caught fire, and then some sort of smoldering had occurred, and then, of course, the flames had consumed her body and the chair. But, of course, it's very difficult to explain something like that. It is also very hard to simply catch fire to an item of furniture just using a drop cigarette.
Well, also, what about the ceiling right above her? Was that examined?
Oh, look, I mean, there was basically the surfaces, that would include, of course, the ceiling and the walls was covered in soot. They certainly didn't identify, any sort of external source of ignition apart from, of course, a drop cigarette. That's really the only thing that they could say might have caused the fire. But the weird thing is, too, that there was a professor of anthropology, Dr. Wilton Krogman. He actually happened to be vacationing near St. Petersburg at the time the incident occurred. He, of course, saw it in the paper. And he was a world-leading expert on, what happens to the human body when it's exposed to fire. And he'd done all sorts of experiments and that sort of thing. So it was a very interesting synchronicity that he happened to be in the area at the time that the incident occurred. And the police actually contacted him and asked him to give his expertise on the case. And he said that he'd never heard of anything like it. And he also determined as well that in order to, burn the body to the extent that Mrs. Reese's was, whereby the bones have also been reduced to a fine powder, you'd need to have a tremendously high temperature. He said it would need to be around 3,000 degrees Fahrenheit, which is around 1,600 degrees Celsius. And there's a quote here that I wanted to just give you. He said, I've been present at tests of body and bone reaction to extreme heat, and it's been established that a heat of around 3,000 degrees Fahrenheit is necessary to completely consume the bones, as happened in the Risa case. And here's the very key part. He said, I cannot conceive of such complete cremation without more burning of the apartment itself. And as I said, that's the really mysterious thing is, you know, normally you'd need a very high temperature in order to cause such dramatic burning. And yet, you know, we find in these cases that that it's really just the body that's been targeted and the surroundings are more or less untouched. The apartment didn't burn to the ground. It was a very, very localized fire. It was really just, focused on Mrs. Risa. And, of course, her chair was affected as well. So, how do you explain something like that?
Well, Lewis's website, by the way, is lewisproud.net. You can watch a video about the book and about Lewis on the website and read his recent posts. It's an interesting site. And, you know, also, by the way, his other books, Dark Intrusions, Strange Electromagnetic Dimensions, The Secret Influence of the Moon. It's all fascinating stuff. Lewis, have we done The Secret Influence of the Moon on this show? I don't think so.
That was a number of years ago. That book was actually written, back in 2012. It was published in 2013. I do recall doing a show with you on The Secret Influence of the Moon, and also Anne was present on that show as well.
Yes.
And she had some very insightful questions. It was a good discussion.
Well, good. Well, okay, so subscribers, if you want to hear Lewis and me and Anne, look into the subscriber archive and you just search on Lewis Proud and you will be able to listen to some of these earlier shows. I think I might listen to that one again myself because I don't remember it. It sounds absolutely fascinating. His new book is Borderland Phenomena, Volume 1. We're having a very interesting time with it. Lewis, there are other cases of spontaneous combustion that you know of. I know the Risa case is an all-time classic, but it's something rare, but not unheard of. And she's not the only one. Is that correct?
Yeah, look, I mean, there are quite a few cases that I discuss in the book. This is something that's, it's been reported for a very, very long time. We've got cases dating back hundreds of years, same as poltergeistry. It looks as though it's something that's been with humanity all along. And also there's some interesting cases I discuss of partial spontaneous human combustion as well. And the interesting thing with those cases is some of them have been witnessed by other people. And the weird thing too is that these people, the victims, they've reported to have or they've the witnesses have described seeing that person go into a kind of trance state before SHC occurs. And with some of these cases, they've been quite dramatic. They've basically seen just, flames just emerge from that person's mouth, for example, or something like that.
Oh, God.
And they've tried to put the person out, throw buckets of water on them, et cetera. And a lot of cases, because it does seem to happen quite quickly, the process of burning, and with quite a few of these people, they've actually died because the burns have been so severe. So there have been cases where people have seen the phenomenon occur, but of course the phenomenon hasn't, of course, reached progressed to the extent where the person's been obviously completely burnt or almost completely burnt and reduced to ashes. Because there have been people there to put out the flames and that sort of thing. So there's some really interesting cases there. But as I said, the person seems to essentially enter a sort of an altered state of consciousness when it happens. And that brings me to an interesting theory, which is the subconscious suicide theory. So there's basically all sorts of theories to try and explain SHC. There's the idea that it might be caused by kundalini energy, that it could be sort of extreme hypothermia, that it could be caused by black magic. But I looked at all the various theories, and I think the most compelling one is the subconscious suicide theory. And if you'd like me to talk a little bit about that, I'd be happy to.
Yes, I would. Yep. Indeed.
Yeah. Okay, so the thing is, we need to, first of all, look at what makes these people unique, the victims of SHC. And the thing that we find is that they're generally people who are basically very isolated socially. So they're people who live alone. That was certainly the case with Mrs. Risa. She did have family nearby. But she was very depressed and upset in the weeks leading up to her death. And the reason was that she didn't enjoy particularly living in Florida. She didn't like the heat and humidity. And she was actually trying to find an apartment back in Colombia. She wanted to stay there for a while to be with friends and so on. But she didn't manage to do that. And it's interesting to note, too, that the telegram that she received that morning was actually one from a friend saying that they had managed to locate an apartment for her in Colombia. But basically, the subconscious suicide theory states that that the phenomenon is triggered by negative suicidal thoughts. And if we look at poltergeistry, for example, we find that generally the activity, or rather at the center of that activity, is a disturbed individual, usually an adolescent. And the leading theory states that it's caused by recurrent spontaneous psychokinesis, that basically these people are very upset and that the phenomena that they cause, which involves, you know, objects being thrown around, etc., and also in some cases spontaneous fires, is caused by that person's subconscious mind. And it's basically a way for them to sort of, you know, let out all that pent-up anger and negativity and so on. And Vincent Gaddis, who was a famous Fortean author, he sort of really helped develop the subconscious suicide theory. I'm pretty sure he was the one who came up with it. There may be other writers who kind of alluded to something very similar. But he compared it to poltergeistry, and he said that in the case of poltergeistry, the energy is externalized, and in the case of SHC, the energy is internalized to the point where obviously the body catches fire. But he said that, you know, we're dealing with sort of two sides of the same coin in the case of SHC and poltergeistry. It's caused by the subconscious mind, but the process by which that energy is directed, or rather the focus of that energy, is different. And he also did talk about the electromagnetic nature of the body as well, because we've got to realize that the human body is essentially a electromagnetic machine. We, of course, have neurons and muscle cells and so on, and all of that activity occurs as a result of electrical impulses. So we have this remarkable, you know, electrical system in the body, and it would appear as though, you know, that's where the energy comes from in the case of poltergeistry and SHC. And maybe in the case of SHC too, we're dealing with a kind of a malfunction of the body's electrical system. It could still be caused by one's psychic state or one's state of mind, one's emotional state. But it triggers a process whereby that electrical system malfunctions, and then that person, you know, ends up bursting into flames, essentially. So,
you know, of course, you're talking to somebody whose electrical system does malfunction. I really don't want to burst into flames. It's reassuring in a way to hear that people have occasionally been put out, but not reassuring to hear that they enter a sort of altered state when it happens, because that suggests that they themselves are helpless. Okay, now let's keep going, because the book is it's just full of fascinating stuff, folks, and we're actually running a little low on time, so I want to race ahead. Let's jump to the Amherst mystery. This is so cool. Tell us about the Amherst mystery and what its significance is.
Yeah, absolutely. So this is just one of the poltergeist cases I discuss in the book. I think it's one of the most fascinating poltergeist cases of all time. It dates back to 1878. It happened in Amherst, Nova Scotia in Canada. The activity occurred around a young woman named Esther Cox. And the man who investigated it and wrote a book about it, and that's where it gets its name from, was a man named Walter Hubble. He was an actor with an interest in the paranormal. And basically, prior to investigating the Amherst mystery, he looked into spiritualism and he wasn't very impressed. There seemed to be a lot of fraudulent mediums and that sort of thing. So he was quite skeptical at that point. And his reason for investigating the Amherst mystery was he was basically wanted to defraud it. So he thought that he would, find evidence that that it was all made up. But he stayed with the family. He witnessed some of the incidents himself, and he came to believe that it was genuine. But basically, it all started when, and I should explain too that Esther was very much sort of the black sheep in the family. She did have apparently harbor feelings of jealousy towards her older sister Jenny. And it was one night that they were lying in bed together, and she complained of a mouse under the covers. There was some movement under the covers. They didn't actually see a mouse or anything like this. And it was on, and this kept happening. There seemed to be some kind of presence there, if you will. And then the phenomena escalated. She did also have, and this is very interesting. She described experiencing a kind of fever, and it was after she'd been in that sort of feverish state, and apparently her there was some swelling of her body and so on, that the phenomenon seemed to break out as well. So, there's certainly was connected in some way to her body as well, or rather her illness, if you like. But basically, the phenomenon kept happening. There was, loud rapping noises on the walls, noises of what appeared to be someone sort of basically striking the cottage with a sledgehammer. And also the other really weird thing was a message that they found scrawled on the wall, which said, "Esther Cox, you are mine to kill," which was very frightening. And the poltergeist the weird thing is that the poltergeist did seem to be quite, malevolent in nature. It really, really scared these people. And when it threatened to burn down the house, that's when things got really scary. And they actually witnessed all these fires just sort of erupt in various parts of the house. And they had to race around and try and put them out and so on. But Hubble looked into this very closely. And it was revealed that the activity seemed to basically vary in intensity in accordance with a 28-day cycle. That would indicate that maybe there was a sexual component at work, and it was actually related to Esther's menstrual cycle. But it was determined that just days before the activity erupted, Esther had suffered a tremendous shock, a psychological shock, when she had been seeing this young man for a while. He was like, I suppose, a bit of a bad boy kind of thing. And he'd actually tried to, sexually assault her at gunpoint. So she experienced this tremendous psychological shock, and it was just days later that the phenomena erupted. So there was certainly a psychological trigger there.
It's a question, did it come out of her, or did something kind of break and let it through?
Yeah, that's the thing. That's the great mystery with poltergeistry is certainly it's easy to link that activity to a living person and that person's psychological state, and yet the so-called entity can behave in a very independent manner. And in this case, the entity was, or rather did, act very independently and autonomously, And the thing is, too, it also targeted Esther. It wasn't just the family members as well. So so who knows what's happening? And I sort of developed this theory that maybe in the case of poltergeistry, we're dealing with, you know, some kind of parasitic entity, I suppose, that sort of attaches itself to a person and then uses that person's energy to cause the disturbances.
Now, you mentioned in another part of the book, this oddly enough is coming to the next question I was going to ask you. You yep. say this, a life form having latched onto its human victim is able to experience the world through their body, to see, smell, hear, touch everything they can. This is not the same as possession, which implies a complete takeover of the body, but rather a form of subtle invasion similar to what occurs when a parasitic entity takes residence in the body of a host. Now, when I do my sensing exercise at night, I'm absolutely convinced that there's somebody who comes in and shares my body. And mm-hmm. I was shocked when I read this because I've never heard that anywhere else. Can you expand yeah. on that a little bit?
Right. Yeah, well, look, I mean, it's really just a theory at this point. But I think what may be occurring in the case of poltergeistry is, these entities or intelligences that are sort of parasitic in nature. Maybe what happens is they, you know, they essentially latch on to, or rather find a victim that they latch on to. It could, I suppose, be a person who is in a very vulnerable state psychologically, etc. Of course, we find in the case of poltergeistry that most of the individuals are teenagers as well. So they could be, you know, sexually frustrated individuals, people who are, I suppose, leaking energy somehow. So we can imagine that maybe this entity latches onto that person and more or less kind of lives through them and steals their energy, I suppose. And maybe what's happening in the case of poltergeistry is that person is, or rather the phenomenon that occurs, the movement of objects, etc., the psychokinetic effects are actually that person reacting symptomatically to that, parasitic entity. Because if we look at other cases of poltergeistry, parasitism, I should say, we find that, if we just look at, for example, the cases where people have tapeworms in their body, basically that person will feel a very strong desire to eat sort of, fatty, sugary foods. And these are things that the entity, or rather the parasitic life form, the tapeworm, actually enjoys consuming, because basically that entity is eating the undigested food in their intestines.
God, how creepy, creepy, Lewis.
But maybe I know it's a totally bizarre theory, but we've got to, imagine that there might be other entities, creatures out there that we can't necessarily perceive that also, are parasitic. But in a sort of in a different way, I suppose that they'd be latching onto that person's etheric body or their aura or something
yeah.
like that.
It doesn't feel like parasitism to me. What happens yeah. with me feels very friendly. I mean, it feels like someone who, after my wife died for a while, it felt like it was her. It feels like it feels very familiar and friendly. Like it's like yeah. I've learned how to do something that people on the other side really enjoy and want to do with me. That's how it feels. Yeah. I don't feel parasitized yeah. at all. Okay. Oh God, I hope I'm just I'm not just blowing in the wind here.
Well, I mean, what you're talking about is really sort of mediumship, I suppose, and I know that you've sort of talked a little bit about the fact that you believe that you are in contact, with Anne's spirit or something like that, and that she is sort of communicating through you. It's very hard to comment on those kind of cases. I think there could be genuine cases where people are in touch with deceased loved ones. But I'd say that's a completely different phenomenon. I wouldn't think that there would be any sort of parasitic component to what's taking place. It would be very much a situation where you're willingly allowing that to happen. But in poltergeistry, of course, the victim, of course, doesn't seem to have much choice in the matter. It simply happens to them, I suppose. But yeah, it's hard to draw any sort of comparison there.
Yeah.
But we're looking at, you know, in the case of poltergeistry, it is very much it's described in quite negative terms. And, you know, we need to realize that the victims are very unhappy people. You know, they're very troubled individuals, I suppose. Although the thing is, when you look at mediumship, there have been some cases. I don't know if you're familiar with a famous case involving a gentleman named Joe Fisher. And he wrote this fascinating book, and I'm amazed that it hasn't attracted more attention because it's an absolutely, absolutely fascinating book. It's called The Siren Call of Hungry Ghosts. So he was a Canadian gentleman who basically he got in touch with this medium, and this medium was apparently able to channel all these spirit guides. And so she was it was like a circle of people. They would go and see this medium, and she would channel their respective spirit guides. So Joe Fisher started to talk to his spirit guide, which was as a sort of a young Greek woman, is how she was described, named Philippa. And so he would have quite lengthy dialogues with Philippa through this medium. And it would seem to be a case of full trance channeling. So when she spoke, it was, you know, she took on her whole sort of facial features changed, and she talked in a completely different voice. So, and, you know, full trance channeling can be a very sort of dramatic phenomenon. But basically, he developed quite a strong bond with Philippa. But he was saying that it basically turned into sort of really a situation where he felt as though this entity had latched onto him and was trying to possess him. And he said that he describes in that book some experiences that sound a lot like a sort of sleep paralysis. And during the SP state, you can experience this thing where it does feel as though something is sort of trying to enter your body, that kind of thing, and it can be very, very frightening. But he came to believe that that Philippa was actually a sort of a hungry ghost, I suppose, a sort of earthbound spirit that was very attached to him in a very negative fashion. And he also investigated all of the stories of the spirit guides, because they said that they had lived on Earth previously and that sort of thing. So he tried to find evidence that they had actually lived on Earth at some point, that they had done all the things that they described, and he checked out all the dates and the names of places, etc. And he couldn't find any evidence that the things that they were telling him were true. And the very sad thing with Joe Fisher is that he also talks about this in the book as well. He said that he started to experience what seemed to be a sort of psychic attack and that sort of thing. He had a number of these experiences where the entity was sort of trying to make him sick and that kind of thing. And he was very disturbed by this, and he ended up taking his own life.
God.
Tragic. And he was a man who he'd written about reincarnation. He wrote a great book on reincarnation. It has a foreword in it by the Dalai Lama. So he basically believed that, you know, suicide was a bad way to go. It was, you know, a complete no-no. It's something he shouldn't do.
He must have really been up against it, boy.
Yeah.
You know, folks, that'll never happen with me. If it looks like I committed suicide, something else happened, probably weird. This is all too interesting.
Yeah.
Life is – Annie used to say, I signed on for an interesting life, and I can't believe I found you. My wish was definitely granted, and it is very, very interesting life. And yours is too, Lewis. Wow.
Yeah.
I mean, fascinating research. I have to we're coming to the end of the show, and I want you to tell us about – you've got another volume coming out. And I'm eager to see it, of course, and I'm sure we all are. Can you tell us a little bit about what you're researching now?
Yeah, absolutely. So the idea is that there'll be a number of volumes of Borderland Phenomena. So I am doing research at the moment for volume 2. And that's going to really focus on mysterious disappearances and that sort of thing. And basically I want to explore the idea that we sort of live within a kind of cosmic hierarchy, if you like, and that there are beings or intelligences more advanced and sophisticated than ourselves that are essentially kind of exploiting us in some respect. So it's going to look at various theories involving the multiverse, the idea that there are other worlds that exist alongside our own, that sort of interpenetrate our world, if you like. And so I want to explore that a little bit as well, and I want to look into some of the famous and maybe not so well-known cases as well of mysterious disappearances. There is a fascinating case that occurred back in the late 1970s involving a pilot from Melbourne, Frederick Valentich, who disappeared over the Bass Strait. He was in a Cessna. He was making a trip from Melbourne to King Island, and he described seeing a mysterious object just moments before he's basically describing it over the radio. He's talking about this strange object that he saw, and he said, you know, are there any other aircraft in the vicinity? And they said no, and then they heard like a sort of weird metallic kind of scraping sound, and then the transmission cut out, and then they never heard from Frederick Valentich again. So I want to have a look at some of those cases as well.
Well, that sounds like it's going to be great. LewisProud.net, Borderland Phenomena, Volume 1. Get started on the Lewis Proud adventure. I find it a great adventure to be on. Lewis, thank you so much for being with us this week on Dreamland.
No, you're very welcome. Thanks for having me on the show, Whitley. It's been a lot of fun.
Yeah, it always is, Lewis. I'm sure the listeners are going to have fun, too, because if I have fun, they have fun, and I had fun.
Yep. Okay. Fantastic. Well, I hope to be on the show again, and we'll discuss this some more of these topics.
Great. We'll do it.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host, and I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander. Thank you for listening.